as the title slide, and there's a little bit of light reading for everybody later on in the disclaimer. I'll start with what is really a summary slide. What attracted me to Anglesey last year when I joined as CEO on the 1st of August was I think a couple of gems. The Parys Mountain Project is a bit of a sleeper. It's been around for a long time. A lot of people would have known, will be familiar with it. That a lot of people will be familiar with the company, and it's kind of slipped through the cracks to a certain degree over the years. But there's an incredible resource up there, and a significant resource of almost 17 million tons at around 2% copper equivalent. And I'm not a big fan of copper equivalents, but we use it because it is a polymetallic, so it has zinc, copper, lead, silver, and gold. Importantly, prior to my joining, the company last year, this time last year, put out a very strong preliminary economic assessment for the project, which assumed 1 million tons per annum, producing circa 15,000 tons of copper equivalent per year, generating some very strong margins. It's still a work in progress. And what excites me about this, fundamentally, is that there's a lot of unfinished business up here. The original or this all the ore bodies that we're looking at now were first discovered in the sort of mid 60s. There's been a couple of attempts to advance them and undone for reasons that are not due to the quality of the project, which we can go into later. But I mean, the other thing that really excites me about this, and I don't want to be cliched about ESG, but one of the biggest industries on Anglesey these days is renewable energy. And when you stand on Parys Mountain and look in all directions, you can see a wind farm pretty much at all points of the compass. So there's genuine opportunity to tap into what we would call low carbon copper from this project. And it's a very, very favourable jurisdiction in North Wales. There is significant infrastructure in place, and we're well advanced in discussions with the county council and town council, and everyone is demonstrating sort of huge support for us. On the iron ore front, we have two assets. The key one in my mind is Grängesberg, which is up in Sweden. It's a large resource. It was a pre-existing mine closed in the late 1980s. After producing about 180 million tons of ore, which produces a very, very high quality and high grade product, a concentrate, Fe concentrate product, which in today's market is highly desirable. And again, very similar to Parys Mountain, a very favourable jurisdiction with oodles of infrastructure in place that we can look to use. The corporate overview. One of the interesting points, again, for me that sort of appeals to me is that this company was listed in the late 1980s, and there's been no rollbacks or anything like that, and we still only have 248 million shares on issue. So it's a, for someone coming in new like myself, it's a nice starting point. Just like to point out on the board of management there, we recently appointed two new directors, Andrew King and Namrata Verma, both very experienced in financing, whether it be equity or debt, and investment banking, and very relevant. And we're very excited to have them join us. Yeah, here's a very, very quick summary of the assets. I'll go into more detail on Parys Mountain and Grängesberg. So this is really more of a reference slide. The third asset we have is this staking in Labrador Iron Mine Holdings, which was assets that were owned by the company that was spun out into a business in Canada, sort of just after the GFC. It got into production. We've diluted now down to a 12% holding. It is an equity stake. There are some common directors, but it's not my focus at the moment. I mean, I see it as a very nice asset to have on the balance sheet, Hopefully, we'll generate some value for shareholders down the track. But I'm not going to spend much time talking about that. So in terms of Parys Mountain itself, what amazes me is I think there is a genuine lack of understanding as to how advanced this project is. It's well advanced. It's genuine brownfields. And this photo is interesting because there's a main road that runs sort of top left to bottom right, and on the right hand side of that road, you can see what looks like a very big scar. Interestingly, I was talking to a broker, one of the London brokers, a few months ago about Parys Mountain and potentially getting some support, and they said, we went to site a few years ago, and we had a look at the old workings, and it's a complete environmental mess. You're never going to get that permitted. So no, we're out. And I didn't have the heart to tell them that really, that's a heritage part of the countryside. We own a lot of the land freehold. We have a very good agreement, a very good relationship and agreement with the local heritage council. That's historic workings there that go back to Bronze Age times, Roman era, and more recently the 18th and 19th centuries. Important, that road is quite an important sort of demarcation line, really, in that on the left hand side of the road you see a headframe and some mine buildings which were installed in 1988-1989, and all of the ore bodies that we're looking at exploiting and extracting here are basically underground at depths down to between 60 meters from surface down to 500 meters below surface, all on that left hand side of the road. So our impact on what is the old heritage site we have no reason to try and change that heritage site. We're very proud of it. We're very proud of our ownership on it and our relationship with the locals. And there's a brand new car park there, and there's walkways around it. It's a beautiful man-made attraction, a tourist attraction. So we see ourselves as the next part of the history of this site. So it's very dear to our hearts. But importantly, in 88, this project was essentially fully permitted, which is more to the point from sort of current discussions. The company raised money through the IPO. It sank a 300 meter deep shaft. It put in a kilometer of development. It took 2,000 ton bulk sample, which was processed through an on-site pilot plant. And that concentrate was sold to Pasminco and smelted down at the Avonmouth smelter down in Bristol. We have planning permission. We have freehold ownership of the land. We have no environmental liability on the old workings. There's lots of infrastructure, very supportive workforce or local potential workforce. And because we own it freehold, it's very low holding costs. The PEA, which was released in January last year, it's a PEA, so it does require more work to get it to a point where we would pull the trigger. But what is really important is that, as PEAs go, there are elements of this PEA that are really, really much more advanced than other PEAs. I mean, there are very few projects in the world that have a PEA on a project that's had a 2,000-ton bulk sample run through a process plant and has demonstrated, the ability to produce a commercially saleable concentrate. So that's very, very valuable. The infrastructure that's in place is very valuable. We can, there's a lot of knowledge in terms of, rock mechanics and how wide you can open up stopes and very important aspects like that feed into these studies. What I really like, and what when I was looking at this, doing my own due diligence on this, what I really like is that the mining study was done by QME. And QME are, they're a large mining contractor over in Ireland. I think probably one of the best mining contractors in Europe. They have the bulk of the mining contract over at Boliden's Tara mine. They worked up from bottom principle, worked this up from bottom, from first principles, bottom up. And fortunately for us, all their pricing is live. I mean, these guys know how much it costs to mine a ton of dirt and to bring a ton of dirt to surface. So, ultimately that mine design will change and will be optimized. But what really encourages me is that their first pass design of this, you can access the entire ore body from an underground development, and that gives us a huge step going forward. In terms of the economics, it's a PEA, so the numbers will change. The studies that we used or the numbers that we used in the PEA were very conservative pricing parameters. I mean, $2.81 copper, $1.20 zinc, $14.75 gold, and $16 silver. If you run today's prices or around the prices a couple of days ago, earlier this week, the NPV jumps from circa 120 US to over $250 million. And that's from a capital a pre-production capital estimate of $99 million. So this really is a bite-sized project from in terms of a funding. Now, again, what I really like about this, and then I'm gonna sort of use the Central Asia model for this, is that, you know, Central Asia have demonstrated you don't have to have big projects to generate strong returns, both for shareholders and for, you know, in terms of capital appreciation and dividends. And, you know, we've got a PEA that demonstrates a 12-year mine life. With exploration, you know, all the shoots are pretty much open at depth and along strike. So we're going to find more. I'm pretty confident of that. You know, over that 12-year mine life, it produces an average of about 14,000 tons of copper equivalent per annum. You know, at conservative costings with byproduct credits, cash costs are, you know, $1.30 a pound. I mean, you know, you can do the maths and work out that this actually generates, you know, significant cash flows on a year-by-year basis for an extended period of time. The metal profile as well is also very, you know, encouraging. It's again, I don't want to be cliched, but, you know, we talk about the electrification and decarbonisation of the economy, and you know, that requires more copper, it requires more zinc, it requires more lead, and certainly silver. And we have that in spades, and we're very encouraged by that. Now, I think it's important to talk about permitting. You know, one of the arguments I get pushed back to me is that, you know, okay, 2% copper equivalent, it's not the highest grade project in the world. And my response is, well, I'd rather have a 2% copper equivalent project in an area that's full of infrastructure and has planning permission in place, and the permitting process is largely complete. I mean, there is some more to do. We're not going to deny that, but it's largely complete. Rather than something that was 3% in the middle of Western Australia or in the middle of, you know, frozen Canada or in Central Africa, you know, there are huge advantages that allow this project to have a capital estimate of $99 million. Now, of the planning permission we do have, we are putting this in for a voluntary review with the Mineral Planning Authority in North Wales and with the local council, because we want to make sure that, you know, subsequent to the Planning Act changes in 1996, this planning permission was granted in 1988, 1999. So we want to make sure that there are yeah, it's all done to modern standards and is acceptable to all parties. Won't touch on the met test, but I mean, as I say, we have a 2,000 ton bulk sample. The current drilling we're doing that you mentioned earlier, you know, we are going to do a little bit of confirmatory test work. And, you know, what we want to do is we want to introduce potentially a DMS pre-concentration sort of process into this, which effectively, you know, you do lose a little bit on the mineral recoveries, but fundamentally you could reduce your bulk going into the into the mill by 30-40%, which has a huge impact on economics and tailings. This is an important slide, protecting the past. You know, we, as commented earlier, you know, this really just confirms what I was saying. We're doing very little on the side of the road where the old workings are. There's the yellow circle there. Whilst it is on that side of the road, on the right hand side of the road, that was where the original pilot plant was, and there was no historical workings there. So we're pretty relaxed about that. And the black shape on the bottom right of the slide, that is where the tailings, we have planning permission to put the tailings plant there or tailings down there. We are in the process of going through new studies on the tailings. You know, the original mine plan didn't have paste fill. We're now looking at paste fill. If we have the DMS, which will drop out, you know, 30-40% of the material going into the plant, and with a paste fill plant and a paste fill sort of operation, you know, the tailings footprint is going to be significantly smaller than was originally designed. In terms of future opportunities, I mean, there's been minimal modern exploration conducted on this project, and that really excites me. You know, geophysics, there's been some very, very sort of basic geophysics done. Geophysics might be hard work, I think, just given some of the power lines in the area, but it's worth a go. And certainly along strike, you know, and at depth, there's a lot of opportunity to extend the known mineralization. This next slide is hopefully sort of demonstrates, you know, what I'm talking about there, in that, you know, this is a long section And the pink ore body there, the White Rock, is where the shaft, the existing shaft, goes down. So all these drill holes that are placed as a guide only. I mean, they are sort of not completely in place just because of the scale, but it gives a demonstration as to just what's down here. And you know, that big oblong is 1.1 kilometers long. It's 600 meters or 500 meters deep. And there are some really, really good intersections in there. And you know, a lot of these have not been followed up. The red oblong is a high grade trend down the middle of it, which you know, we have every intention of following this up. You know, they are amazing grades, and yeah, there's some incredible widths in there as well. I mean, 146 meters at 1.22% copper equivalent. I mean, the bulk of this is copper in this northern copper zone. I mean, if we were releasing results like that, in the current market, you know, we would not be a £9 million market cap. We would be significantly higher, in my view. So this just gives a sense as to you know, what's left to do here. Now, this is the former broker in me. This is a very simple chart that just plots, you know, resource versus copper equivalent grade, and the bubble size is enterprise value per copper pound or per pound of copper equivalent. And I've used, you know, what I think are genuine global comparatives that are listed in you know, the UK, Canada, and Australia. And as you can see, there's quite a tight bunch in terms of, you know, resource size and grade size. So we're very much in the mix for these potential development opportunities. But then you look at our bubble size, you know, we are so undervalued on a relative basis. I mean, our nearest competitor would be, you know, probably, I think, would be an Eagle Mountain, which is EM2 listed in Australia. Yeah, that's 30 cents a pound copper equivalent. We're at 2. So it gives you a sense as to where I think we can take this. That's just tabulated. And just interesting on this slide, the peer group average resource here is 19 million tons at 2.5 copper equivalent. And they all have a slightly different mixture of metals. Parys Mountain, as it sits, is 17 million at 2. And it's going to get bigger. So we are very, very well situated to mix it with our global comparable companies here. I'm just conscious of the time. So really, I mean, Grängesberg, you know, it's not got a lot of airtime, you know, historically for the company, which is probably because we only own 20% of it, or 19.9%, but we do sort of have management of the project, and we have a right of first refusal to go to 70%. Now, what I really like about this project is, again, it's leveraging off existing infrastructure and historical operations. Yeah, there is a large resource here. I mean, it's still circa 150 million tons at 41%. It's a magnetite project, so it upgrades. Yeah, you concentrate and upgrade it to a very high quality product. The original mine produced 4 million tons. There was a pre-feasibility study done here in 2012 that demonstrated a 16-year mine life, producing 2.3 to 2.5 million tons of premium high grade iron feedstock per annum. The numbers that came out of that were very encouraging. Look, it's not the cheapest in terms of capital. I mean, this is a big project. You know, there's 4 shafts that need to be dewatered. You have to build a new concentration plant. My preference wouldn't be to take it to pellets. It would be to just have a study that looks at producing concentrate and selling concentrate. But it's perfectly positioned to assist and to feed the European steel market. And my sense is that in, you know, post-COVID environment, post-Brexit, you know, I think there's a few points of tension around the world, and you know, people are looking to shorten their supply chains, and this is a wonderful feed into, you know, the Swedish steel industry, which is leading the world in my view in terms of hydrogen powered steel plants producing carbon neutral steel. So look, we're updating the pre-feasibility study now. We hope to have the results from that study to internally by the end of the quarter. My sense is that it's going to be a very interesting project. From that point, we'll decide where we go with it. But finally, we don't just want to do the ESG for lip service. You know, we believe that with Parys Mountain, it's a very, very underfunded part of Anglesey and North Wales. And we honestly believe that, you know, reopening a mine here and having a successful development here will genuinely make a lot of difference to the community and the island. So